Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Everyone, welcome to this, the final meeting of the Alamance County Commissioners for the year 2011. Wish you all the best of season's greetings and hope everybody's ready for the holidays. As we begin, I'm going to ask the Associate Pastor of the Baptist Temple of Alamance County to offer invocation tonight. Reverend David Carter, if you would be so kind as to offer the invocation, and welcome and thank you for being here.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to start out and say Merry Christmas to you and to all the commissioners, to the staff and everyone else here tonight. Merry Christmas. I'm going to say that as much as I can while it's still legal. So I want to say Merry Christmas and thank you for this opportunity. I'll try to keep my prayer within 3 minutes, so see what I can do. May we pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for each person that's here tonight to represent different issues and all of the concerned citizens that are here and those that work in the county and the commissioners. We ask that you grant us much wisdom. Lord, for many people, this time of year is a difficult time of year as they struggle. Christmas season is not always a wonderful and pleasant season. Some have suffered a loss in their family. Some have suffered financial loss, maybe the loss of a job. Others maybe receive some bad news about their health. But Lord, in the midst of all of it, help us to not forget the true meaning of Christmas, the birth of your Son and our Savior, Jesus Christ. We think about him being wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in that manger over 2,000 years ago and what that might have been for those new parents who had no place to lay their child. We think of parents in this community, many who are struggling this year financially to provide power in their home, to provide energy, to put food in the mouths of their children, to provide protection for them. And that's why what we do here in these meetings and what the commissioners do and each and every person that runs a department throughout this county does is so vitally important to the citizens that are within the county limits. And we just pray that you'd give us much wisdom. We thank you for the sacrifices of the brave men and women who fight for our freedom both at home and abroad. As I spoke to a young man yesterday, a Marine sniper, who is in on leave back from Kabul. Lord, we just pray for their protection. As he said, I couldn't wait to get home to see my wife and my child. Lord, we have so many blessings that we take for granted, so many things that we don't even think about when we wake up in the morning, the breath we breathe, the car we get in, the house over our head. For many of us, we have secured jobs and we have the finer things of life, but for others, it is a difficult time of year. We ask that you be with us. Continue to keep your hand upon our county. Watch over us. Keep us safe. We thank you for the protection we have, that the fire and the police and the Sheriff's Department, EMS, each department provides. We thank you for them. We ask that you meet their needs and as they go out and render services throughout the community as well. I ask that you just do all of this in your name, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for being here. Before we go into the public comments, Craig has a change to the agenda that he would like to propose. Commissioners, I'd like to review the agenda and consider Craig's request to add an item. Craig?
Yes, sir. If we could go into our closed session to discuss economic development.
Okay, and that would be after the county manager reports. We also have, since we're talking about the agenda, at least two items on the consent agenda that we would like to pull for discussion. Mr. Lashley, you had one, I believe.
Yes. G.
Item G.
I think that's right. F.
Item F, the Water Resource Development
Resolution. G and F, I want to pull.
G, the request for proposal for the Criminal Justice Partnership Services. So we'll pull those two while we're talking about the consent agenda. Any other members want to pull any items? If not, we'll consider the consent agenda without those two. We'll add that other need to go into closed session for discussion on economic development matter. And with that, we'll consider the agenda approved. Okay, I have two requests for public comment tonight and would like to begin by welcoming Jimmy Hargrove Mr. Hargrove lives in a snow camp, and I'm not sure what you want to talk about, but please come to the podium. Welcome.
My name's Jimmy Hargrove, and I've recently had two illegal trash dumpings on my personal property. And I have all the police reports and the pictures to prove the dumpings were illegal. And I would like at this time to give these pictures and reports to you so you can see firsthand of what I'm dealing with. If that's okay.
Sure. I'll be fine.
Okay, the first dumping occurred in mid-September, and the second dumping occurred the first week of December, both in 2011. The first dumping consisted of around 300 automobile tires, and the second dumping was a pickup truckload of shingles. Now I'm willing to clean up the illegal trash myself and haul it to the landfill in my own truck, and I am not asking for any county employees to help me in the aid of the cleanup, nor am I asking the county to write me a check for any amount of money to aid in the disposal. All I'm asking for is a legal place to dump the illegal trash and permission to just simply drive into the landfill with the illegal material in my truck, back up to the trash pile, pull the lever, and dump it out without being charged a dumping fee, simply because I don't have a legal place to put the illegal material and to keep from having to pay for someone else's mistake. If you can help me with that part of it, then the whole situation will be resolved. I think using common sense can turn a difficult situation into an easy solution. In my way of looking at this, it's a problem within the county, and it should be taken care of within the county instead of passing the problem on to the state. If there's no law on the books for hauling illegal dump material to the landfill, when it can be proven by the landowner with police reports that it's an illegal dump and not charge the victim a dumping fee, then it is my opinion that it needs to be one put in place. Thank you. Appreciate the time you gave me.
Thank you, Jimmy. We have your contact information, I believe. You have what I don't see is a phone number on here. If you'll give me a phone number, I'll pass this along to the county manager, and staff can review the situation.
I'd like to speak to this in public comment, if that's okay, when it gets to it. So.
What is your phone number, if you don't mind sharing it?
227-9356.
Okay.
I'm going to give your police reports to the county attorney here, if it's all right, or county manager, and I'll give the pictures to him as well.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Jimmy. I'm sorry you're experiencing that. Our next speaker, our last speaker, is Henry Vines, resident of Isley Drive here in the county. Henry, no stranger to us. Welcome. You have 3 minutes, and you heard the...
Thank you, Commissioners. My name is Henry Vines, and I live in Snow Camp. I come tonight in support of Jimmy. Jimmy come to me and asked me what could be done, and I've tried to direct him in the direction of y'all and all. But I would also, tonight, I was under the understanding, and I know that y'all have been looking into it, that we already had an ordinance in place that would allow illegal dumping to go to the landfill without a tipping fee. I know there were some discussions on this years ago, and I'm speaking on behalf of the farmers as well. You know, this was an issue that's came out before. Illegal dumping could be, get to be a bigger problem as economic times are. And certainly, the property owner shouldn't have to foot the bill to get rid of it. And if we don't have an ordinance in place, or we need to change the ordinance, or we need to make some amendments even to that, or to the landfill policies that would allow, you know, an illegal dumping to go to the landfill without tipping, I think we need to consider that. Not only for the, you know, for the citizens, all citizens, our, you know, the farmers as well. I just ask that y'all look at this and consider this. If it's not already in place, that it is something that we need to look into and change. And I'd appreciate y'all's support on that.
Thank you.
Thank you, Henry. Eddie, do you want to respond to that?
Well, I talked to Jimmy at length today a little bit on this whole issue, and I'm assuming you're the one, your department wrote the report.
Yes, sir.
And I was just curious as to maybe actually to get Greg to come speak to any situation. I know in the past we have let people, like on cleanup days or whatever, put items in.
That's correct. We have had clean sweep days in the spring.
Greg, I'm sorry, but yeah, for the mics, I probably right. need to have
some. I hate to put you on the spot.
Yeah. Greg.
Oh, no problem.
I'm sure you didn't rehearse this for 2 hours. So welcome.
Yes. We have in the past had cleanup days in the spring and then the fall clean sweep days. Of course, our public, our highways and waterways, that is picked up free of charge. We historically have not had a waiver of fees on private properties. I think the one exception was years ago when people purchased property that maybe 10, 15 years had been disposed, things have been disposed on that property, there was one-time allowance of a waiver of tipping fees. But our issue at the landfill, and certainly I'm sympathetic to this, I know I spoke with Jimmy at length about this, is it is a state, we're subsidized by the state for the disposal of tires at a rate of $76.57 per ton. So what we do is we turn in our tonnages quarterly to the state, and then they pay us back. Last year it was a total of $154,000 for the disposal of tires, the hauling of tires, actually. So it is a state issue as well. We're accountable to the state for the monies that's redistributed to us. Via a 2% tax on tires when we purchase tires, when we all purchase tires. So it's a redistribution type situation. But certainly on the direction of the board, we'd be glad to work with case-by-case basis if need be. We don't use tax dollars to operate the landfill, as this board knows, as well as other folks. So we want to be good stewards of our money. And in other words, we can't, and we don't want to create a situation where we're waiving tipping fees and it becomes commonplace. Because that is a slippery slope for us. So, and I have spoke with Ethan Brown with the state relative to this situation, and I think there probably will be some monies available for Mr. Hargrove. My estimate is around $250 for this disposal, and I will certainly follow up with that.
Now, would that cover the disposal of the 300?
We went out Friday and we looked at the load, myself and Vicki Ashworth with the Environmental Health Department. In fact, she got a 2-inch nail in her foot as we accessed the property and took pictures. He had a 2x4 across there to covered up in case the people came back, and the problem here is the culprits that dumped.
Yeah.
And I understand his frustration, and as I share with him, that is the problem. If we can find the perpetrators that did this, and that's who we want to find and have them clean up. But suggestion I have for him is I would post the property no trespassing. I would certainly do that. And I would certainly put up a cable or something at that entrance so that it would not have unfettered access to that area.
Well, 300 tires is not just a casual homeowner throwing a couple tires
out of
his car.
Exactly.
That's somebody that probably got paid that 2% and they double.
Exactly.
Dipping because they're just getting rid of them.
Right. And I know Mr. Hargrove has been very frustrated, and we, you know, we want to work through this process with him. And I don't think that he's going to have to pay for the tires, but it is a process, and we want to follow.
He said he's willing to get them to you if you can help waive the fees.
Right.
On, so.
And I think the state will subsidize that, and I'll certainly be in touch with him. But as far as waiving or tipping fees, upon the direction of the board and or Mr. Honeycutt, that would be a decision this board could make.
And if the board is agreeable, what we can do some research on if they're, you know, what waivers are other counties do it and how they do handle that waiver. And I'm sure under specific circumstances that is allowed. So, I think Greg's concern is we don't want to open up Pandora's box and begin waiving everything. You know, that everything becomes waiver because it is an enterprise fund and it has to subsidize itself on the revenue it receives. So, but there are extenuating circumstances sometimes.
Well, I think with a police report to go along with this, that, I think he's done due diligence as far as the citizen of the county, and if we can.
And that may be what other communities do. If the board likes, we will be glad to bring you back a memo and a synopsis of what we find at the next meeting, if that is the board's wishes.
Well, I'd like to see it.
Yeah, whatever you guys think is appropriate. I guess my question is for the sheriff. I think what Eddie said is right. I don't think this is a case of the homeowner getting rid of this.
It's,
this is
it's
why. Does this
not
happen a lot?
No, sir. Not just not. I mean, a lot of trash dumped all over this county. But tires, this is the first ones we've seen that I'm aware of since I've been sheriff. And I can tell you, it wasn't just one load dumped there.
It's significant.
We have tried to take serial numbers off the tires and trace it, and with no success, which tells me probably it may have even come from out of the county. Don't know that.
And it's the expense involved. It's $76.57 per ton. People don't want to pay that.
Right.
It is a problem. And you can dispose of up to five. Individuals can come to the landfill and dispose of up to five free of charge, not just in Alamance County, but surrounding counties as well. So, FYI.
All right. Very good. Thank you, Greg.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Sheriff. Before we go into other commissioner responses, I would like to follow up on a public comment we had last month from Mr. Carl Buckland, who is here with us tonight, who has submitted a petition to the board that I would like to read. And I would also just like to comment, it has to do with our comment period and the length of our comment period and the 3 minutes that we allocate for each speaker to speak on the part of the issue that they would like to share, which is more than welcome. But the 3 minutes is a number of minutes that has been selected by this board to allow enough time for public input, but at the same time not take away from the orderly flow of the business meeting. And just to remind everybody, this is a business meeting that's open to the public, but it is not a public hearing. If there are certain items that need to be discussed by staff, of which Mr. Buckland brought a very important issue to our attention last month, then that is referred to staff and staff can follow up. If it is an item where we expect or request large input from the public, then we do schedule a separate public hearing either at the beginning of this meeting or at a separate time altogether. In the case of Mr. Buckland, if you don't mind me sharing your issue from last month, it had to do with the allocation and water, how would I describe it, Craig?
The assessments of payback to the county
from city
lines that the county helped install.
And because of your comments, I know that the folks from the county staff met for a long time with the municipal folks in Burlington to address this. So, again, we appreciate you bringing that to our attention. And do you have anything to report on that? Or
I did a memo to the board earlier in the week, or I guess it was late last week, and basically, the discussion was with the city of Burlington, if lines are put in with CDBG money, which is Community Development Block Grant money, that is not allowed to be assessed according to their rules. There cannot be an assessment added on to those lines. So if there are lines put in, we can't do the assessments. It's interesting to see how the city of Burlington handles assessments. Assessment plats by the city are not digitized. They are basically in an old scrapbook. They're about anywhere from 20 to 40 years old. They're plats that are placed in a scrapbook, and there's no clear accounting of what's been collected and what's not been collected. Again, most of what they have is handwritten in that scrapbook. So there's not accurate accounting of records, there's not accurate accounting of agreements, because each agreement is different. Some are 5 years assessment period, some are 10 years, some get extended. They're not consistent. We also look back to see when the last time the county was paid for any assessment. The last that we can tell was in 2007. The county received $1,630 or $13. However, we can't tell which property it was for. You know, so we didn't have a good accounting of it. So that was a downfall on our part. Again, the assessment agreements are not consistent. So with respect to what they have done in the past, nothing is consistent, nothing is well accounted for, nothing is well documented. However, if we do move forward, one of the things we did talk about, we need to update the agreement. You know, if we ever get money or ever do a joint line again and we do assessments on it, we need to update the agreement to make sure everything's correct, and we both know the expectations of both parties. Also, they're beginning to work with their GIS department and their accounting software to just have a better accounting of exactly where the lines are and what has been collected and what's not been collected. So their assessment issue is a mess. And it's very difficult, I think, to go back. The amount of money to the county, I think, is very difficult to see what's owed and what's not owed, or what's been paid and what's not been paid. It's about to the point, how do we move forward from this point? So.
And you're going to have a subsequent meeting to address that issue?
We are. I believe the city right now is going to try to digitize their quote-unquote scrapbook. And again, if we do any more assessments, we would have, you know, a much better joint agreement on that.
And you and Mr. Albright have agreed to meet with Mr. Buckland individually if the need
yes.
arises. And I would encourage you to schedule that meeting and follow up with Craig. Now, what I'd like to do at this time is read the petition that was presented to the board, came after our December 5th meeting. Pursuant to the First Amendment of the United States to the United States Constitution, I, Carl David Buckland, Sr., hereby petition the Alamance County Commissioners to increase the time allotted for citizens to publicly comment at their meetings. In support of this petition, I show the following. Item 1, if the County Commissioners had listened to a citizen, Carl Buckland, long enough at the December 5th meeting, they would have been able to understand that the county was losing revenue. Number 2, in most instances, one cannot go to the toilet and wash their hands in 3 minutes. Number 3, at the December 5th, 2011 meeting, Mr. Manning led the commissioners in prayer by giving the invocation. He said, "Dear Father, please help us to understand the issues, to listen to our citizens." That's why Associate Pastor Carter gave the prayer tonight. Number 4, what a hypocrisy to deliver such a prayer and only allow 3 minutes to understand the issues and listen to a citizen's public comments. Item number 5, do not get me wrong, I too believe in seeking spiritual guidance through prayer. I will stand with anyone for that right to pray in church, school, and public buildings anywhere, regardless of denomination. Item number 6, I would like to suggest that time be allotted for a moment of silence so that everyone can, if they choose, seek their spiritual guidance through prayer. And item number 7, the King James Version of the Bible, Matthew chapter 6, verses 1 to 8, offers us guidance in prayer. Thank you, Mr. Buckland. Other commissioner comments?
May I comment?
Not at this time.
No.
Tim, Linda, anything? I'd like to share I'd like to share just a couple of things. Linda and I had the pleasure of attending the rededication of the Pleasant Grove Community Center and Park on Saturday. It was very well done. Brian, you and your folks did a great job. Linda, would you like to comment on that?
Well, I've been in on that from the very beginning, and one time we thought we was going to get whipping out there when we went to the meeting because they were so mad because of that they didn't think they were going to get their gymnasium fixed back, and they didn't think they was going to get a building out there. And let me see. This is what the old school used to look like out there, and we tore that down out there, and now the gym is really, the gym caught on fire is what happened. And so Mr. Haygood got through and got some money from that, then we fixed the gym back, and it is absolutely beautiful now. And the citizens are happy. They have a modular out there now, which was very, Mr. Burgess was handling that, and Mr. Epps, and that modular now suits their needs out there that they were complaining about, so we didn't get a whipping when we went back. So it was very... It was really good for me, too, because I used to live out there, and all those people knew who I was. So, but anyway, they're happy now, and they've got somebody teaching art out there. It's really a great look. They got exercise equipment out there, and they're happy now. So as long as we can make some people happy, I think that we're fine with it. So, but thank you, Brian, for all your work, and Mr. Burgess, too.
Thank you, Linda. Mm-hmm. Again, just to add to what Linda said, Brian, it was a great ceremony, and I really appreciate the involvement of the community, the folks that were there. People involved had one of their relatives sing a couple of songs, and it was a very, very moving ceremony. So, we also, last week, christened a new train engine in the city of Burlington, and a couple of us had the opportunity to go there, Craig and Tim. Is anybody else from the county there? And I just real quick story, there two engines came into town, and the first one said there was a date, and it said High Point, and the second one said 1893 Burlington, and everybody was, of course, you know, hovering over the Burlington train. So I pulled the guy from the NCDOT aside, and I said, what's the High Point train doing here? Are you going from here to High Point to dedicate that engine? He said, no, we dedicated that one a year ago. I said, well, what's it doing here today? Well, the engines were back to back. He said, well, there's no place to turn around. We got to lead it back with the other one. So, well, that was kind of interesting. So the Burlington train didn't actually get started until on the way back. So that was good. We had the opportunity of all county employees. Jeremy Atkins participated in a real good talk on the GIS system to the Commercial Realtors Group. And if you have not, and you use the GIS system, you have not use it lately, there's some real good updates, and he did a real good job doing that. And then finally, since we last met, we met with the school board. A couple of representatives of the school board are here tonight to discuss the fund balance and the issues of budgeting that had kind of started here earlier, and basically left that meeting with the hope that our county finance situation will continue to improve. We won't necessarily have to reduce allocations. We don't know that for sure, but in either instance, the county manager and the school superintendent are going to schedule meetings to talk about fund balance and fund balance policy and funding formulas and so forth. So overall, I thought it was a real good meeting, and thank you all for inviting us to attend. Tony Rose and Patsy Simpson are here with us tonight. Okay, now any more comments? If not, we'll move on to the agenda for the PARTF grant application. Brian, our Alamance County Recreation Parks Director, will present us the information on the PARTF grant.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good evening, Commissioners. I'm here this evening to talk to you about an opportunity the county's been given, and that is to acquire approximately 78 acres adjacent to Cedar Rock Park. Property is located between the park gate and Friendship Patterson Mill Road. If you're familiar with Cedar Rock, you've been out, you know, you turn off Friendship Patterson Mill Road up Ardeen Coleman Road. That is privately owned property from Friendship Patterson Mill Road all the way to the park gate. Property we're talking about this evening is all located on the right-hand side of the road as you go in. The biggest opportunity here and the main priority of this potential project will be to preserve and conserve that property, to protect Cedar Rock Park. I don't know if any of you remember, I was not with the department at the time, but the original entrance to Cedar Rock Park was on Garrett House Trail, which turns off Highway 49. That was used for a number of years, over 10 years. It went through existing development, and it, due to the high traffic Cedar Rock gets, I think we got almost 135,000 visits last year, the county realized very early on that was not going to work. And in fact, county worked with the Patterson family to acquire an easement over this land I'm talking to you about tonight to get into the park another way. It just was not working for the county. It wasn't working for the residents either at that time. What we have here at this time is a possible jump on the development that could come out on this property between the park gate and Friendship Patterson Mill Road. This is the last way to get in and out of the park. There really isn't any other way to do it. Most of our park visitors believe that this property already belongs to the county. They think this is already county-owned property and a part of the park. And we feel, as a staff and most of the park visitors would agree, that their experience at Cedar Rock really begins when they turn in. Going through the pastures, you can see Cane Mountain Range. It's a very beautiful piece of property. And eventually, if the county was able to acquire this property, it could provide additional recreational amenities on it. It's possible that it could. But again, let me stress, the number one reason we're interested in it is to possibly conserve it. There are other tracts of property around Cedar Rock Park for sale, several. We are only looking at this piece because of its importance to the entry and exit to the park. The families that own the tracts, I'm going to show you up here on the map in just a moment, they are selling this property. It will be sold. They understand that the county may be interested in purchasing it, and they are in fact willing to work with the county to help make that happen. And I'm going to talk to you tonight about several grant opportunities that we've identified, and we want you to possibly let us go after. These families know that, and they know that that could take some time. It may be sometime next year before we know if the county have the money or not. They're willing to wait for that. I think they understand the county's desire to preserve Cedar Rock. So, our department, we understand the financial situation the county's in. We know that times are tight, and we know that the county is watching its finances very carefully. We also know this is a very unique opportunity to possibly make this happen. So what we've done is tried to come up with a funding strategy that will let the county buy this property without burdening itself financially. And I'm going to go through some of these opportunities. So basically, when I'm done, we'll have two requests. We'll be asking from this board permission to apply for a PARTF grant. That's the North Carolina Parks and Recreation Trust Fund. We've applied for three over the past 4 years and been successful twice, so we know this grant. And also for a new grant we've never applied for. It's the one that the resolution is on the consent agenda, which I'm going to talk about it too tonight. That's the Water Resources Development Grant. This is a state grant. And both of these grants are, they require a match. They require a 50% match. So anyway, what we've tried to do is come up with a way to present to you to try to pursue this property without putting the county at financial responsibility to buy it out of its own funds. So this
Ryan,
time,
before you go on,
yes, sir.
I want to make sure it's okay with Bill on this item F that we're pulling off consent. So you're suggesting you want to include that in your discussion at this time?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Okay. I'll cover its terms and explain how it would work if we decide to pursue it.
But it's two different. It would be two different motions.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you.
On the map, you can see here in the green is Cedar Rock Park as it exists today. And then the two shades of purple, those represent the two tracts owned by the two different families. You see Friendship Patterson Mill Road. There's Ardeen Coleman Road. All this is property on the right. Patterson's own 53.34 acres. And then the Isley family owns approximately 25 acres. What we're proposing to do, now the property that's really visible as you come into the park is the Patterson property. However, the Isley property, we're going after two types of grants to try, well, we're proposing to go after two types of grants to try to make this happen. One is a recreational grant, that's part of it. The other two are more environmental in nature. And that's Rock Creek there, that is the border of these two tracts. So when you look at the two purple pieces of property, that's Rock Creek. And What we found is because Rock Creek borders these properties, it lends itself to some possible environmental grants that are water quality. That's what the Water Resources Development Grant is a part of. So we're interested also in the Isley property. It will help us, we think, make a match for part. So just to kind of orient yourself, there's Cedar Rock and there's the two tracks. Now, both tracks have been appraised by state-certified appraisers. The total acreage is approximately 78 acres. The estimated price to buy both tracks is $496,000. Patterson track appraised for approximately $6,900 an acre. The Isley track appraised for $5,000 an acre. The reason the Isley track appraised for a little bit lower, it has more floodplain on it. The topography is not as suitable probably for doing a lot of development. The Patterson property, if you're familiar with it, if you've been out there, that's the cleared part, it's very low. Both of those costs add up to $496,000. What we're proposing that you consider, we do, is apply for a part of grant for $248,000. That's for half of the purchase price. PARTIF requires a 50% match. That means the county would have to find the other $248,000 somewhere else. We're proposing to do that through the ways that are listed here. One is an application to the North Carolina Environmental Enhancement Grant for $145,000. This grant does not require a match. In fact, we have applied for this grant because when we learned that the individual that owned the property passed away, there was a very short window of time to get this grant in before its deadline. And we felt like since it didn't require a match, we would go ahead and apply and get it in the mix, asking this grant is through the North Carolina Department of Justice. What it is when Smithfield Foods down east have Hog Lagoon spills, the state fines Smithfield Foods, and then the state is required by law to use that money to buy property for conservation purposes in the Cape Fear River Basin, which we are in the Cape Fear River Basin, and Rock Creek feeds the whole river, which is in the Cape Fear River Basin. So we qualify. We went ahead and applied, but there's no match. We're hopeful that we'll get it. Second grant, and that would be $145,000 to try to match the $248,000 from PART. Then we identified the North Carolina Water Resources Development Grant. This grant is another match. And when you read the resolution, when you look at that resolution, it says the county will promise to meet all project costs. The reason it says that is because it's a matching grant. What we would propose to do is meet the project costs with the other grants. So the total price, we're applying for $75,000 from Water Resources. Only $50,000 would be for property acquisition. Water Resources wants you to actually do some work besides just buy the property. So we're applying for an additional $25,000 from them to do some work, and I'll show you a development map in a moment, but to do some work on a dam on one of the ponds on the park property now. But again, as the resolution reads, the county would be responsible for covering all the project costs. What we would do is, if funded on these grants, we would be able to use the grant funds to meet that requirement. We also currently, at this time, have $20,500 in designated fund for the future development of Cedar Rock Park. These are funds that have come in through donations for years since the opening of the park. People sometimes give us money because they love Cedar Rock and they want to see it made better. Or we have events that have raised some funds and they give us the proceeds. We've been able to put together, over probably 30 years, $20,500. We would suggest if we proceed, this would be an opportune time to try to put it in the mix to help offset these costs. We've also had discussions with several of the user groups that enjoy Cedar Rock Park. This would include our disc golf folks, our equestrian. We get a tremendous amount of horse use at Cedar Rock Park. We think on our own, with help from these user groups, we could raise at least $5,000 in some benefit type activities to help the county create funds to make this purchase. That still leaves a $27,500 gap that is not covered by the EG grant or water resources or future development or fundraising. We've had some very preliminary discussions with some local business folks. We may be able to solicit those funds from some of our industry here in Alamance County. We've also would suggest that we could do some sponsorships inside the park. Currently, none of our picnic shelters are sponsored. They're just shelters 1, 2, 3, 4, stuff like that. Our disc golf holes, we have 36 of them. They're not sponsored either. If we proceed with this effort, we will start trying to solicit sponsorships for those things inside the park and try to create, excuse me, this $27,500. So what we're talking about is one application departed for half the purchase price, $248,000. The county has to build $248,000 to match that. We would do it through applications to the EG grant, water resources, using our own designated fund, limited fundraising, and then sponsoring opportunities within the park. We would have about 6 months to put this together, but we feel like this is a good quality project and it could be done. Again, as these grants are funded, the county always has the ability to say no. To say no, you know, if we only got, let's say out of all of this, the only grant that we got was water resources development. Even though you approve this resolution tonight, if you choose to do so, we're not committed to having to go through with the project. The $50,000 won't come close to buying the property. It's just a part of the overall mix. So all of these grants are like that. Until you sign the contract with the state and actually spend their money, the county is always able to extricate itself from this process. Now, I'm going to show you this development map, and the reason I'm going to show it to you, I said when I started that our number one priority out here is to preserve this property. However, PARDIF is a recreational grant. PARDIF wants to see what the potential development could be on this property. Now, we're not applying for any funds from PARDIF or anybody else except water resources to fix the dam. We're not applying from any funds to do any of this, so we won't be on the hook promising anyone that we will actually do any of this development. But in order to qualify for PARDIF, we have to show them that there are some potential rec use. This is a map that we've put together in conjunction with different groups that use Cedar Rock Park currently. You can see that we could foresee in time, it might be 15, 20 years from now, there's no telling. We could foresee, because we get so many horseback riders at Cedar Rock Park, we think that we could certainly expand our horse trail. Had about another, I think it was a mile and a half of trail. Then we would also possibly be able to stall some horse camping specifically designed for people with the big rigs in there and camp. Again, not committed to do it, but it's a possibility. We've also heard our park visitors say that they would like to have a disc golf course that would target kids, nine hole small. Not what we currently have are 36 holes of top-notch, known across the Southeast as good quality places to play. But for people to learn how to play, you take your small child out there, it's very difficult to do. So we believe that this could be a possible form of development, a smaller disc golf course on the property. We also have a tremendous amount of use for our tent camping. However, in the county, there's not any car camping opportunities where you can pull your car in. If you've ever been to a state park, you know, some of the state park sites, you pull your car in, they have a little pad that's made right near where you park your car. You can get out and camp. It's mostly for families. We have primitive right now. You have to hike in. We believe, based on discussions with our visitors, this would be something that the public would enjoy. We also would foresee the possibility of adding a dog park, probably within the existing confines of the park. You know, we get a lot of people come to Cedar Rock with their dogs, and we spend a lot of time telling people they need to put them back on the leash. So they've told us they would love to have a place at the park to let them run, you know, free without a leash. So anyway, this gives you an idea of some possible uses. We had to show this to the public because we had to make sure that what we tell PARDIF wouldn't conflict with what the public might want. And I have to show it to you tonight, of course, to give you an idea that while this could happen, we're not asking for money to make it happen. Therefore, it doesn't necessarily have to happen if we get funded from PARDIF or anyone else. I think that's the last slide. I'm going to go back to this because I'm going to take your questions, but I have a few other points. I believe, and the staff agrees, that these applications are all very strong ones, basically because Cedar Rock has a tremendous use. We get, as I said, I think 135,000 visits last year. We get a lot of traffic. That's going to be an attractive grant, we believe, for PARDIF. Also, because this is a project that will protect that park, it will help keep any development that might be a conflicting land use between the park and along the main entry road from happening. These grants, EEG and also water resources, the water quality, we're in the Cape Fear River Basin. We believe that they would make a strong case to fund. They don't like to fund the entire project. They like to be a small piece of projects. As you can see, both the environmental grants, EEG, and water resources, they don't make up the whole grant. They're only a small piece of it. This also fits within our master plan. You know, we went through our master planning process back in 2007, and one of the number one issues identified was the fact that the property between the park gate and Friendship Patterson Mill Road was not owned by the county, and that if the landowners were willing to sell, the county should try somehow to put together the funds to make that happen. The Parks Commission, the Alamance County Parks Commission, has reviewed this funding approach and has recommended to the board that you allow us to proceed with this strategy. They've been briefed on this too. We've explained to them that, you know, our desire and our goal will be not to put the financial burden on Alamance County, to try to find ways to do this from funding aside from county funding. We had a public PARTIF meeting on December the 10th. That's required by the PARTIF grant application. We had approximately 50 people turn up and talk to us about the plan. People were supportive of the idea of the county trying to acquire this property, and no one, we had neighbors attend, we had property owners attend. No one found the possible development plan objectionable, which is important for me to be able to tell you tonight. Again, what we would try to do is use grants and outside funding sponsorships to make the matches for the grants that we apply for. You know, if we got one grant, if we received one of these and didn't get them all, we can extricate ourselves from them if that's what you choose to do. And again, the water resources grant that's on consent, that resolution is a part of that application. And again, it does say the county would be committing to covering the cost of the project. We propose that we would cover the cost of the project with these funds. That's where they would come from. We believe this is a worthy effort, and we think it's worth the try to see what we can acquire. Again, if I leave here tonight and the board has voted to allow us to go after PARTIF the Water Resources Grant, the county is not on the hook for any money at this time. I would certainly come back and tell you if we reach a point, and I would stay in touch with management, if we ever reach a point where the county becomes in a position where it's going to have to put its own money on the hook, that's where I'm talking to Craig, and I'm coming back to you and telling you that. Tonight, that is not the case. What we're asking for is the ability to pursue these two grants and try to put this together. So at this time, if you have any questions, I'll be happy to try to answer them.
What's the total acreage at Cedar Rock, inclusive of the 78?
There's 414 acres there now.
Okay, and then you add 78, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Can you go back to the map while we're talking about that?
So in the green, it's 414 acres at Cedar Rock at this time. You can see, if you look up Ardeen Coleman Road, there's another little road up there near the heading that comes in. That's Garrett House Trail. That's the former entrance to the park.
I'm going to give you three other parks. I'm just curious. Joe Davidson, Northeast and Guilford, and there's a park over in Kernersville. Is that Hall River? Is a park there across from FedEx where...
You know, yes, sir, I do, but I don't know the name, yes, sir.
And I've been through all three of those. Do you know the acreages of those three?
Northeast, I believe, is approximately 700 acres, but I'm not 100% sure of that. Joe Davidson, for some reason I want to say Joe Davidson is about 50 to 60 acres, but again, I think so. They have several ball fields, but it's not a huge nature park. They do have walking trails and stuff, but... I wouldn't want to be held to those figures. Those are kind of best estimates. And the one in Kernersville, I'm not sure. I know which park you're talking about.
Right on the county line.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. I drive through that all the time, and it's massive.
Yeah.
And on weekends, it's packed. And Northeast has been fairly successful.
Yes, it has. It has. They have a very diverse offering up there. The pools. They have nature trails. They also have athletic complexes too. Which at Cedar Rock, the county has held the development to very passive. And the possible development that could come in time, if we stay with the passive theme, it generally tends to be the less expensive to install, and usually over time, it's the less expensive to keep up too. I mean, if you're not keeping up, massive buildings, that's where you really run into your costs. But.
Now they're going to expand from Raleigh to the zoo in Ashburn. That may be below the highway. But are you familiar with the expansion of the road they're going to do to the zoo in Raleigh? I mean, Ashburn?
Not intimately familiar, no. I may have read the article about that, but I'm not.
That's going to increase a lot of traffic flow through the southern part of our area. And then the interstate's going to come down through Ashburn, if I'm not mistaken, on 220.
So yes, sir.
It'll be surrounded by a lot of good roads in the future, so.
Well, I want to be sure I stress to the board that this is probably the only property I can think of in Alamance County that would bring me here tonight. I mean, we certainly know how things are financially. And again, even knowing that, knowing how important this property is, I think, to the park and its experience, and to avoid possible future problems, we still think we've put together a doable strategy to find funding from somewhere else. We believe so. I can't guarantee any of this. I can't promise you that any of these grants would be funded. I can't promise you that we would have success with corporate. But what I can promise you, we would do everything we can. And again, if it got to the point where the county was going to have to do something with its own money, I would make sure that was very clear to this board. But that's not where we are this evening.
And Mr. Chair, if I could say, when Brian brought this to us, we basically gave him a very clear directive as far as management is that the county is not in a position right now to go out and purchase property. And we basically, the directive back was to be creative, to find different ways to look at funding this property, because it is a unique opportunity with the property being available. But I do want to reiterate, and Brian's done a good job on this, and appreciate the work that he and the other Brian has done as well. We're not looking at putting county dollars to this. We're just trying to be very creative. It's really like a house of cards as well. If one falls, the whole project may fall apart. This is really best case scenario for everything to be funded and rewarded. But again, if it falls apart, we will directly come back to you and let you know where we're at.
Well, and we may have better success with sponsorships and corporate help than we see. I mean, we're thinking a goal might be $27,000. We've had some very preliminary discussions with local business about would you be interested in helping make this happen. I think there are a lot of local businesses here in the county that realize Cedar Rock's a benefit to residents and might be interested in having their business be a part of helping make that happen. The commissioners, I believe it was about 2 years ago, approved some sponsorship policy for our department that we want to use to help make some of these funds. So it may be that the Water Resources grant does not come through, but we may have better success with corporate or private help that make it, maybe it wasn't, we were able to do without. But I guess what we need formal permission to apply for PARTIF and for Water Resources via the resolution that's on consent.
Let me ask you another question. Could we sell that property in the future if we decided to?
If you buy it with some of these funds, it would be extremely difficult to. PARTIF would be very difficult to do it because they immediately start putting restrictions on the property. It has to be used in perpetuity for recreational use. Some of the environmental grants are going to have conservation easements that they're going to put on the property, because that's their goal, is to buy and conserve the property. They're certainly not opposed to it being part of a park. It could be done, but it would be very difficult.
Could we put a sheriff station substation there?
It is possible if it's not in the area that's conserved. Again, by not having your own funds to buy this land, that puts us kind of at the whim of the people who will fund it. So they're going to want to put easements on some of this property that may make that kind of development impossible, because of the impervious surface that would create. I think it would depend on which of these panned out. But it's possible, yes, it could be done.
Could you put a cell phone tower on it?
I think we have the existing ordinance would prevent it. There's an existing cell phone tower ordinance that would prevent it due to its proximity to the historic farm at Cedar Rock Park, because we've had that issue come up before. But, you got the historic district there at Cedar Rock for the farm, and I think there are a few ordinances that would regulate. Cell phones would be one. I don't believe you could on this property.
Brian, what's the current use of that? Isn't that pasture?
It's in ag. It's ag use right now. Yeah. It's in farm use pasture, and the Patterson property that you see there, a great deal of it is cleared already. That's why it appraised a little higher. It's already cleared. It's level ground. It's out of flood.
It's back to Henry. Keeps cows.
Well, from our point of view, we certainly see the value and the possibility for future recreational use. Absolutely, our priority is to preserve it. So if we purchase it and it just stays as farmland with everything that's happening on it, great. It's not developed in a way that makes it difficult for park users, or if you put a development there of 40 or 50 homes, we'll be running hundreds of thousands of people right up that road. And that's if you've been out that road, it's small, and you will be running right through their neighborhood. It would probably be detrimental for everyone. That was the problem on Garrett House Trail. But
Brian, you mentioned a lot about the funding sources, but I don't believe I've heard you say much about the purchase price. Have these been locked in with these property owners?
There's no option. Nothing agrees. But there's no formal agreement between the county and the property owners. What they have told us, they have seen the appraised values. They've indicated they would sell for that
and
price.
How old are the appraisals?
They've just been completed within maybe 60 days, maybe less.
So based on our new economy?
Yes, they are very new.
Right,
I think they may have been actually completed within the last month. But this began. This opportunity presented itself, I think it was in October, so or roughly in that October time frame. So we've met with the property owners and kind of talked to them about our interest, and we feel they would sell us the property for this, but again, we don't have any kind of a formal arrangement with them to.
And somebody else could come up to them tomorrow and make them an offer.
Yes, absolutely. And they understand that this is a timely, for example, Pardiff and the Water Resources Development Grant will not announce until next May. So, and those are the EEG grant announces in February. So they understand, the families understand that there's some time here, that they would have to wait. But I do believe, we've had good relations with our neighbors out front since we've been there. I think they understand that there's a lot of people come to Cedar Rock, love Cedar Rock Park. They understand the county has an interest in this. They also understand what's going on today financially and that, we're looking at a little time period. But no, that's not to say they couldn't do that. They could.
And you have three applications listed there, but our understanding is that you are requesting consideration for approval of the PARTF and the WRDG, but not the middle one. That's the one you've already applied for.
We applied for that one because it required no match, and the time limit wherein it was due was so close. We discovered it. We knew about it. We went ahead and applied. Again, you would know if we got it. We would have to come back before you for some of the grants we apply for. If we don't come here first, we have to come here when they're approved because you do the budget amendment that puts it into our budget. So even at that time, you would be able to say no. So there's really no opportunity for our department to do anything financially that y'all don't know about.
Yeah.
And that's good. That's the way it should be. These two grants, because they're matching, we need to come to you beforehand, explain to you. The two part of grants that we have two part of grants that we have been awarded. We have no match. The matches have been created by donations by county residents. And, for years we wanted to apply for part of because it's the rec grant. But we didn't have the match. We have just really been fortunate that so many people in Alamance County are gracious with their property and believe in some of the projects that we're working on that they're willing to say, because that's another way to make the match is donated land, bargain sales, things like that. So it's not impossible to do it without the match. It's difficult, and sometimes you have to go along with the funding source, and you may lose the ability to do everything you could have wanted to do with the property. But, understanding that, times are tight, we think this is a possible option.
Sheriff, is that too far south for any future consideration for any substations?
No, sir. The closest thing we have to there right now is in the village of Alamance, and that's a substation there. It's the closest we have.
How many acres would it take to put in something? Service.
Probably an acre.
what my point is I hope we can be innovative here, and I would think the grant approval would be based on whether we bought 78 or 77. Or 76 acres,
sure.
And we could be innovative with this and try to get 2 acres broke out of the package because I don't think the seller cares whether we do that or not.
As long as he gets the money, right?
Yeah, so I think we kill 2 birds with 1 stone here rather than just get one and some
I agree, and most of these grants that we apply for, they like to see they're a part of a big project. And, depending on the success of these grants, we get a lot of use from law enforcement and rescue at Cedar Rock Park for training, tremendous amount. Canines, we also get rescue comes out and does training about backcountry, and those kind of things. So it might even be that, we may be able to tap some kind of funding that might help, you know, make that possible or help it continue to happen. So, I mean, we're open to any possible funding source that would help make it make this work. And I can't imagine that having a substation out there would be anything but a boon to us, because it would certainly be a deterrent for crime. And if it's something that would also help the sheriff, you know, serve the way he wants to, fantastic. But it is possible that, I will talk with Partif and see if it's something that would necessarily have to be broke out from the Partif property, or it might just be something that we would have to make sure was not in floodplain or violating any conservation easements. But.
Sheriff, you still have the substation down in Saxpaw, don't you?
Yes, sir.
But that's probably another 10 miles southeast.
Yeah.
From Cedar Rock?
Yes, sir. What about the, would there be a possibility using land that's already acquired by the county of Cedar Rock Park or putting a substation there versus that being purchased?
The county bought the park property in 1972 or 3 with LWCF money. This is an amazing fact. The county bought that entire Cedar Rock Park for $160,000.
Wow.
And the match was another $160,000 from the LWCF, which today I can't imagine what a 400-acre park would cost, but it would be high. I would have to check because it was bought under terms of that grant. And let me check and see if that's something. But either way, one thing that would be attractive is if there are funds to help make it happen, federal or some other kind, it would be great because it could be a match for us if it was on the new part of the property. So I'm just not as familiar with law enforcement and that, you know, the building and structures for them with these grants, but I'll certainly be looking into it.
Thank you, Brian. Are there any other questions or comments for Brian or for the sheriff or the county manager?
Chairman, I know this is not public comment.
It really isn't, Henry. I'm sorry.
What I was concerned about, the reason I wanted to bring this out of the consent agenda, was I was concerned that the county was going to get roped into having to pay for any land, and now that Brian's covered that situation and we're not going to, I'm in favor of this.
Yeah.
It's something that the county definitely needs, and it will help the recreation.
We won't get this opportunity again,
right?
Because if it goes
that's
out
true.
And
that's a great chance.
And you serve on that committee.
I serve on that committee. That's why I was aware of what was going on with it.
Okay, well, let's take these two separately, if we may. The first one is the PARTF. See, I won't say Part F because I'm on the Park Board.
Part F.
That confuses me, so I'm going to stick with the PARTF grant application for $248,000. Is there a motion to allow County Rec and Parks?
So moved.
Thank you, Bill. Second by Eddie. Any other comment or discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you. Well, let's go ahead. We pulled it off. Let's go ahead and vote on the second one, if that's all right with everybody. The
motion that we accept.
The Water Resources Grant. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Eddie. Any other discussion or questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Very good.
Thank
Brian, thank
much.
You.
Thank
well, you for your time. Thank you for your homework.
The board and county manager updated as we progress. Thank you.
Very good. Okay, budget amendment number 72 from the, well, I guess, what, 72 and 73. Well, I can't tell what's, okay, 72 is from the library, 73 is from the health department. So we welcome our resident librarian. How are you this evening, Mel?
I'm fine. How are you?
Good.
Mr. Chairman, members of the commissioners, I have a budget amendment. We had our state aid cut because we did not make our maintenance of effort, and so I had to find areas to cut, make those cuts in our current budget. So my proposal was to cut, I have to cut $10,181, and so my proposal is to cut $6,618 out of our book line item, which is $560. And $3,563 out of our AV budget.
You want to tell us what the maintenance of effort requirement is?
Maintenance of effort is what the state library requires your funding body to maintain. It guarantees that your funding body understands their responsibility. And so every year, when I apply for state aid, they have a minimal amount that my funding body, which is the county, is supposed to meet. And they get that figure by taking the average of the previous 3 years' operating budget. But for us, that includes our capital outlay because that's where our materials come from. So they give me that figure, and if my budget meets that figure or is above it, then I get my full state aid. If my budget falls below that, then they reduce that amount by the amount, the percentage that I'm below that maintenance of effort.
And the maintenance of effort then is defined by how much funding you get from the county.
Yes. Yes, sir. It's the average of the three previous years.
If you were cut by us, then it affected other funds.
Right. So every time my budget gets cut by you all, then I get an additional cut from the state aid. So for libraries, it's a double whammy.
Any questions of MJ? Or I'm sorry.
I was just going to say, so because the budget was cut 4.89%, that's what my... I had those
questions.
Cuts.
Is there a motion to accept this amendment, which would lower funding in these two areas a total of $10,181?
Second.
Second bill, thank you. Any other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you, MJ. And now from the Health Department, Mr. Barry Bass. Welcome, sir.
Mr. Chairman. Yes, sir. Thank you all for this opportunity to basically bring some good news in the fact that Alamance County, you all may remember back in September, I did a presentation about Project Launch, and you all were amenable for us under the terms to apply for that grant. And so as of November the 1st, we have been funded. And the other kind of frustrating part is this is like the first increment of it. They'll give you, it's like spits and spatters, and you come in. This is $132,000 towards that grant. And we are one of three health department-based grants in the country. There are 23 other grants that are located throughout the United States in terms of projects. And the actual grantee from Sampson, North Carolina, is the Division of Public Health, and we are their sub-grantee. And we're their local effort, and basically the idea is we have statewide implications that if we do a really good job of implementation in Alamance County, that can be a model for our state. So this is a super opportunity for us, and again, we're tying back into our early childhood grant, and as I discussed a lot of the other nuances of the grant with you all a couple of months ago. But we're excited about this possibility and bringing some folks on and getting some good services, expanding our services to children and families in Alamance County with social and emotional needs. So I'd be happy to address any questions that you all may have. And at the last board meeting, also you had talked about the evaluation component, and UNC Greensboro over the course of the year would have $125,000 grant as part of the overall grant. And then Duke University has $173,000 as part of the ABC Learning Collaborative. Those were things that the state had set up prior to us coming on board. So we'll be fulfilling these obligations with them. And so at the end of the day, we'll have somewhere around $750,000, of which $450,000 would be to Alamance County. This is our first increment of that.
Very good. That does sound kind of encouraging. Any other comments? Is there a motion to approve this amendment?
Second.
I'll second it.
All right, thank you, Eddie and Linda. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
Thank you all. Merry Christmas to all.
Okay, performance management and performance-based budgeting update. Mr. Tim Burgess, welcome, sir.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I've been sitting there practicing for the whole time saying I'm going to say Mr. Chairman, and I come up and say Madam. But anyway, Mr. Chairman, my apologies.
I promise you, they can attest. I've been called worse.
Okay, well, that's good. I have too. So anyway, and members of the board, good evening. I need to practice a little more, I guess, on that. Again, here to talk about performance-based budgeting to give you an update on it. I do have department heads for those departments that are participating in here to answer any technical questions. Have Brian, Susan, Bruce, MJ, Richard, and Chuck, and then Susan with finance here to answer any of the more technical questions that I may not know. So just want to give you a quick overview of what this program is, and then talk a little bit, just some examples from each of the departments as to some of their results. You do have in your agenda packets the full reports for all of the six different departments that include their goals and their results for most of them are for July through October, so the first 4 months of the reporting period. So just very quickly, the first part, and there's really three parts to this or three phases to this performance management and performance-based budgeting. The phase that we're in now, which was implemented July the 1st, is the performance management part, and that is basically where departments are looking at trying to improve make improvements in productivity, efficiency, and or customer service within their departments. So they have set goals and they have set standards that they want to achieve, and that's in order to improve those. That has really, for the most part, does not have any budgetary implications. The goals that they've set, some of them may save some money, but for the most part, they're looking more at the issue of productivity, efficiency, and customer service and improving those. The second phase of this, which will be implemented on July 1st of 2012, is the performance-based budgeting phase. And that is where they look for areas within their budget where they can save money. If they have achieved the goals in the first part of this, the performance management, and have reached their goals, then based on a monetary policy, which the board will approve at some point in the future, then they are able to take part of the savings that they have experienced and put it in, and save it to be able to use it for items that they would normally not be able to budget. The rest of that savings goes back into the county's general fund coffers, which hopefully will be put into our fund balance and can build our fund balance up. So that's the hopes of that process. When will these two are separate, two separate things. The performance management is separate from the performance-based budgeting, but they do merge at some point, which will be as of June the 30th of 2013. Once they have experienced savings, if they have met their goals, then they get to keep part of that savings, and that's why I just discussed. That would be as the results as of June 30th, 2013, and then sometime after that date is when those distributions of those savings would be made to the departments. The participating departments is Department of Social Services, Emergency Medical Services, Geographic Information System, Maintenance, Recreation and Parks, and the Library. And here is basically the time frame. The period that we're in now, July 1st, 2011 through June 30th, 2012, the performance management goals took effect again, as I mentioned earlier, on July 1st. We're tracking those, measuring those now. We're keeping the commissioners periodically updated on that. The period now is using to see, and you can look at some of these goals, and they have more than met their goals. Some of these, they're achieving them at 100%. Their goals were something below that. We're going to tweak those goals. Some of those goals we may throw out because we're meeting them. Some of them we may have to adjust the raise the goal or the standard at which they're trying to achieve because they've already achieved it. So this period is we're using to try to get those goals where they should be correctly so that when we start rewarding monetarily for those goals that they've had, they've been accurately set. So the next thing that we're looking at during this July 1st of this year to June 30th is trying to come up with a monetary policy. That'll be done by the participants in the program. It'll go to the county manager for his approval, and it'll ultimately come to the board for your approval. The monetary policy is basically to define which budgetary savings will qualify for the program and then how these savings can be used. So that's what we'll be working on starting after the first of the year. Then what will be done the next year, July 1st, 2012 through June 30, 2013, the new goals or modified goals based on observing them this year and seeing where they were set correctly, those will take effect at the beginning of that budget year. Department heads will identify areas within their budget for potential savings and work to save money in those areas. And then the Board of Commissioners, of course, will continue to be updated periodically on that. The results as of June 30th, 2013, the savings will be distributed to the departments at sometime after July 1st of 2013. And just want to go through quickly with each department. I just picked out one goal that they had just to kind of give everybody an example of what we're looking at. Department of Social Services, they had five broad goals and a total of seven specific goals of things they were measuring. So they've been measuring seven specific things. This is just one goal I picked out, and the goal was, specific goal was, we will maintain the number of children who are repeat victims of substantiated maltreatment at or below the federal benchmark of 3% annually. So the goal was to keep it below 3%. And you can see for July, August, September, and October that they have reached that goal and kept it below 3%. So you can see they achieved that. The next one is Emergency Medical Services. EMS had four goals. One of their goals is to reduce the maintenance and repair time for vehicle fleet, and they wanted to complete 5% of vehicle repairs within 12 working hours of repair requests. And once the vehicle was delivered to be repaired, they wanted to have 65% of those occasions, they wanted to have the repair work done within 12 hours. They also wanted to complete 65% of all vehicle repairs in-house, so that because they have an in-house mechanic that does work for them instead of having to carry the work outside. And in essence, that would save them money. As you look for the months of July, August, September, they had 45 total number of repairs. 45 of them were completed within 12 hours, so they had a result of 83%. So that's above their 65% goal. So what will happen is Chuck will need to tweak that this year because he's already reaching that goal. So he may need to move that up to 95% and figure ways that he can actually get more than 83% of those vehicles repaired within the 12-hour period. And then the other one was the number of completed in-house. Had 54, of course, vehicles come in. They were able to complete the work, 47 of those, which was 87%. Again, he's already exceeding the 65% goal. So for next year, he'll need to look at raising that goal up and trying to get more work done in-house and figure ways to do that so that then when he finds savings, he can be rewarded for that. So that's what this year is to continue to evaluate these goals to make sure they're properly set. GIS, he had three goals in GIS. One of the goals was respond to 90% of phone calls within 8 hours. What he found is, and you can look at July, August, September, and October, the number of calls he had, and they were responding to these within an hour, because these are actually measurements in hours. So 0.73 of an hour, however number of minutes that is they are achieving that. So their goal was what they thought would be reasonable. But once you start tracking this data, you figure that either you're doing what you thought you were doing, you're doing a lot better than what you thought you were doing, or a lot worse. And so that it gives you, because a lot of times our perception of what's actually happening within our departments is not reality. So what he found is Bruce found out that they were actually getting these phone calls returned within an hour. And so they've already reached their goal. So Bruce is going to look either to say that we need to get 90% of these things done within 10 minutes of the phone call, I don't know, or something. So, you know, he's going to need to realize that 8 hours is just too long a period as a goal. Maintenance. And Richard had a goal, and this one does actually save money. It requires some upfront money to be put into doing this, but it actually in the end will save you money. And this is one of the goals that will save money. And this is Richard had five goals for his department. One of the goals was to replace 50 existing fluorescent lights per month with T8 technology. Richard was hitting that up through October. You can see his goal and the number they actually exceeded for the first 2 months and met their goal for the second and third months, or third and fourth months. What happens is, and this room was done about 6 months ago, Richard?
Yeah, about two or 3 months ago.
And what is the percentage of energy cost that you'll save by putting these lights in?
We played a trick on you guys, and I shared this with Mr. Lashley. This is all T8 technology. We're burning about a third of the energy we were last year.
And what's the recoup period from?
Anywhere from about 15 to 18 months.
Okay, so you're up front.
Enough energy to pay for the retrofit of the light.
And then once you get through that first 18 months, then it's just savings. That's when you'll actually see the savings. The problem we've got here is when we got into November, and I think we have just this month run out of budgetary reasons. We don't have the money now to start continue to replace these lights. Hopefully we can get back on that program in the future. So that was one of Richard's goals there. And recreation of parks, Brian had four goals, but he had 20 different categories that he was measuring. The first goal he had was to provide high-quality recreation programs and facilities, and the measurable was 90% of Cedar Rock Park shelter users will rate their overall experience as excellent or good. His goal was 90%. He hit the first month he didn't hit that, but the last 3 months he well exceeded that. So Brian will need to be looking at whether this is a goal that he wants to continue to. I don't want to speak for Brian, but I envision that this is something that Brian will continue to monitor. Whether he'll include it in the performance management, performance-based budgeting program is another issue. But he would like to continue to make sure that there are citizens out there or the users are being served well. So, and then the last one, I believe, is the library. The library had four areas with 14 goals that they were measuring. This one was in the collection management area. Their goal number three was interlibrary loan borrowing. They wanted to decrease it by 50%. You can see for 2010-2011, the number of interlibrary loans that were taking place for each month. Their goal was to reduce that by 50%. And you can see that they exceeded that, with the exception of this 1 month, that they did exceed their goal. So this is one of the goals that she'll need to look at, MJ, maybe tweaking next year, because it's been pretty easy for them to achieve this, or they've been able to achieve it. So they'll need to look and tweak those over this next year, so that when the money becomes tied to this, we want to make sure that, again, as I said earlier, these goals are reasonable. So I'll be glad to take any questions that y'all may have at this time, or any of the department heads or that y'all may have any questions for. You do have all of their goals before you.
When will we start to see dollar signs?
That will be when we start with July the 1st, 2012 through June 30th, 2013. That budget year is when the department heads will start identifying areas where they're going to try to save money in those in their budgets, and then at the end of that budget year on June 30th, 2013, we'll look at how much of their goals they achieved and whether or not they're able to keep any of the savings that they achieved also. And so those will be distributed sometime. They'll be identified as of June 30th, 2013, and they'll be distributed sometime after July 1st of 2013. Part of it, again, will go back to their own budgets. Some of it will come back to the county for either to be used, something else put in fund balance, or whatever the monetary policy, however it addresses that. Some of the advantages with the department savings that they can realize, that they may be able to carry those over for many years. I think one policy, and I think it may have been Davidson County, had where they could carry those over for up to 10 years before they had to spend it, and that way they could acquire things that they maybe normally would not be able to get into their normal budget process. So, again, and I think we may have talked about this, with as much as with the expenditures that have been cut over the last several years from the county, hopefully we can still see some savings, but it would not be as much as we would have if things would have still been normal, because we have had to cut a lot, and so we won't, hopefully we'll still see some savings, but it won't be as great as what we would have hoped for if this had been done, you know, this program had been done many years ago. So.
What about the other departments that are not currently doing this? Are you devising an integration plan?
Well, we're hoping that if by the experience of these agencies, that some others will get on board with it. So we're hoping, because it is a volunteer program. It's not, and nobody's being, some have been coerced, but nobody's been forced to get on the program. But to be honest with you, we're trying to get a good handle on the departments we've got, and so I have not put really any effort into recruiting other departments in for the future, but that's something that we do need to be working on. So.
Well, Tim, you've been involved in this, I know, more closely probably than a lot of others. What's your read on status?
Tim and I went down to Davidson. This is how this started, and I agree with Tim that starting now is not going to show what we would have shown had we started at the same time Davidson started
right.
theirs.
That's correct.
I think they have saved, what, a total of, what, $7 million, they
I'm
claim?
I'm not sure, to be honest, with what they're saying.
I can't remember the exact dollar figure.
But, you know, Davidson was not fat to start with, you see. And, you know, the only, you know, they're fairly lean, and they were recognized nationally for their successes. And I still question why we're not being able to show. I realize what you're saying. Mm-hmm. But I'm not sure that we're implementing it as a business would. Let's put it that way. We're implementing it, in my opinion, the way a government would. You know, I can't imagine that we can't save.
And if I can,
I agree. You know, and I don't mean to be. You know, I agree that the economy has put us in a mode here to where it's not. More net than it is gross. I agree with that, but you know, I still believe that there's more of a dollar sign that we can attain from this rather than just job duties.
Right.
And
I think, and there's another component. You can, these programs are done differently. I mean, different, but you can use this program to actually kind of drive both public policy and monetary policy. And I'll just use an example. I mean, of course, what we're doing in the first phase part here is we're just trying to see improve productivity, efficiency, and customer service. And that's been very important. And some of the results has maybe been surprising some of what we maybe expected. But for instance, and I'll just use EMS, say that this board, that the response time for EMS was not where, and they do an excellent job, but let's say that y'all said, you know, we'd like to cut that response time by 40%. So y'all said our policy is that we're going to, our public policy is we want to decrease their response time by 40%. In order to do that, we're going to have to build some substations and add ambulance and add personnel. But as the board, you said, that's fine. We're wanting to reduce the response time by 40%. So as a budgetary policy, it costs, just throwing this out, it might cost, let's say it costs $2 million. And you said that we're willing to invest because of their response time. Or you could say, you know, we're fine with them getting there, it taking them twice as long to get there as it is now. I'm not proposing that because we don't want to go that duration. And how much savings would be equated to that? And so you can drive monetary policy like that. I'd rather go the other direction where we're decreasing our response time. But I, with any of these departments, with Brian's satisfaction with, you know, his users at Cedar Rock Park, whatever money they're, and they're having to invest money into the park to make sure that their satisfaction rate is above 90%. If you said, you know, 90% is not good enough, we want it at 95%, then it's going to take more money to make that happen. And so as a board, you can decide that you, if you've got some department that you said, you know, I'd like to really see what they're doing. I want y'all to survey them and to start tracking it and see what the results are, because we really want to change and make that either the customers more satisfied or either respond to the request quicker, whatever, or we're y'all responding a lot quicker than you really need to, and we're wanting to decrease the response time and save the county some money, then those kind of things can be done. And I think that's more probably with what you're getting at. And so those are, you can use this program to drive budgetary policy if you want to, if you have a desire to do that.
Just an example, Bruce's department evidently is doing very well. Bruce doesn't need any more personnel, it doesn't look like, because he's responding.
Well, he's got a lot of other things other than returning phone calls,
right,
so I'll defend him there. But
you know, when you start looking at numbers like that, that does kind of help to say, you know, this department is well staffed and can handle what they need to handle.
Right, and you know, we've got impressions as to what our departments do, but until you really start surveying them and getting some data, you really don't know what's going on a lot of times, what's going on, and you need that data to be able to properly determine which direction you want to go and all
that.
You
gotta have a starting point.
That's right.
To figure it out.
That's true.
Any other questions or comments for Tim? Well, thank you for that update.
Mr. Chairman, thank you.
This
and I apologize.
Is,
I'll practice.
Information item, and we're not taking any action at this
That's
time.
Correct.
Thank you
for your time.
Thank you for what you've done.
Yeah.
Thank
you.
Before we go to item 8, which is the Commissioner's Committee assignments, I would like to go ahead and discuss the other action item that we pulled from consent, because after that, then we just have our reports. And just as a prelude to that, this is about the request for proposal concerning the criminal justice partnership and the services offered. Two things have happened that affect what we do locally through judicial services. One is state legislation last year called the Justice Reinvestment Act of 2011, which is still this year, I'm sorry, last session. That act basically will abolish the Criminal Justice Partnership Program as we know it, and also the Advisory Board effective June of 2012. At the same time, we've had two key retirements announced, one already done and the other one coming up, that basically presents an opportunity to restructure judicial services here. And Susan Osborne, who, and by the way, thanks to all the department heads that are participating in the budget performance, and Susan is one of them through DSS. Susan is going to speak to this subject, not as her role with DSS, but as chair of the Criminal Justice Partnership Advisory Board. And I would also ask Linda Massey, who served on that committee, if you've got any input as we kind of review and get updated, please share that as well. So, Susan, welcome
sure.
to you.
We also, thank you, we also have another member. The sheriff sits on that committee as well, and he's with us. So, as Chairman Massey, I mean, Manning, I'm sorry, outlined, boy!
3 years is a long time.
It is.
Excuse me, Craig, would you write down Burgess's name?
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Has outlined some of these changes. So, what's going to happen with the Criminal Justice Partnership is that they will be put, the funds will still come to Alamance County to provide for offender-based services. And Alamance County has been very successful with its criminal justice partnership program. We exceed the state standards. For example, today we received our latest numbers, which says that in Alamance County, our offenders are completing the programs that are identified for them at a 75% completion rate, and the statewide average is 54%. We're also, our offenders that we're serving are 53% are staying employed, and the state average is 43%. Also, our recidivism is much lower than the state. So the program, the funds will come to Alamance County, but in a different way. And so the new Department of Public Safety that becomes a department January 1st will put out an RFP. The Criminal Justice Partnership Board has been meeting over the last 6 months talking about this change that will go into effect. And so the RFP will offer an opportunity for entities, private entities or government entities, to apply for funding to manage these services at the county level. And it will be open to nonprofits as well as government. Our judges have met with Craig and the partnership board, and they really would like for the county to consider continuing to coordinate these services for our offenders. What happens right now in the courtroom is the judge will sentence someone or have someone before them, and they can say, I'm referring you to judicial services for task program, for criminal justice partnership program, or something like that.
I'm sorry, the TAS is an acronym for? Oh, I got you.
Yeah, you did. Because I live in the criminal partnership world. Something, alternatives to street crime.
Okay.
Alternatives, there's a T in there. But TASC is, Craig might want to speak to TASC. Because there's a big change coming with TASC.
Right. TASC is, we are currently subcontracting with Coastal Horizons, which is, who does the task programs for this half of the state. And with the two retirees that we're having, with Al Jean Tarpley and also with Gary Cole as of March 31st, it was changing. And basically what Coastal told us was they were planning to take back over task and do it themselves with the retirees, because they were basically subbing back to us out of respect to Al Jean and to Gary and the wonderful job that they've done. So that, along with the changes to CJP funding, it was an opportunity to do things a little bit differently than we do now, because currently we were the only county within the state that provided task services like we were providing. So it was now our opportunity to basically put that program back with that private provider.
So the change that's coming, basically what the Criminal Justice Partnership and our judges would like for the county to consider is that we've had good outcomes because of coordinated service. And so when this RFP goes out, different providers have an opportunity to bid on different parts. We'd really like to encourage a provider to look at the sexual offender treatment and substance abuse and keep it coordinated. But if we don't have a provider that's willing to do that, the judges would like for the county to consider responding to the RFP and subcontracting it and still keeping it coordinated for the court system. And so that's what I'm here tonight to ask for, is permission to assess the RFP that's coming out in January. It'll have a pretty quick turnaround time. Work with the county manager. Well, as Brian said, we're well aware of the budgetary restraints. I think Craig has already planned for some savings with the divestiture of judicial services. We're well aware of that. We want to look within the county government. Are there places that the subcontract piece could be, and we could still get the bang for the buck and get the coordination and the good outcomes? So this is not written in stone, but we do have to respond rather quickly to that RFP. So I'm here to ask you if we could look at it, work with the county manager, and respond. I think it'll be due before, maybe even before you meet again in January. So,
and do you think it's going to cost the county more county funds or less?
We wouldn't do it if it did.
Right.
Okay. No, sir. No, sir.
No money.
That's our guiding principle as well.
At judicial services and investing that program, there's a cost savings of about $150,000 to the county.
Right.
If this program, and again, we do have some obligation to it, may cost us 20. You know, we're still way ahead of the game of before.
Substantial savings.
Substantial savings of where we're at right now. So there may be a cost, but not at the cost that the county is currently, anywhere close to what the county is currently putting into that program.
Right. And the other thing is, we don't know what the funding formula looks like, right. So if it's not advantageous, we wouldn't be applying.
Exactly. We're not looking at changing the way, we're looking at really how we can divest ourselves from it, but still provide the service at a very effective and efficient rate.
With some in-kind, like maybe some office space, staying right across the street at Youth Services Building, some right of those things.
Lynn, you want to comment, being a member of that committee?
Well, as you can hear, it's a very, very good committee, and it's well worth whatever. We don't know what we're going to get at this point. So it is worthwhile, and it just helps the county with these people to keep them from going back to jail. And so I think the program is great, and I think we need to keep it if there's any way possible.
I want to be clear on exactly what you're asking us to approve, though, because what I think I heard you say last was just approval for consideration of submitting an RFP, depending on what the other RFPs, or what the specifics of the RFP
expectations in the RFP, and to have permission to work with the county manager to respond to that, because we may have to do that before you meet again.
But we will not know, and you will not know, what other providers may be bidding.
No.
So if somebody's going to come here and bid for the whole thing, which would be preferable, there would be a single contact. It's not necessary then that we would automatically want to fill out a request. So
that's right. And so we're going to put our feelers out with some of the other agent nonprofits that are providing in other communities to see if they have an interest. For example, Freedom House does Caswell and Orange and some of Chatham, and they do the coordinated service piece.
So they provide everything.
Yes,
including, when you say coordinated services, if the judges want one person or one contact,
one agency.
Okay, they have that. Just like now they have the county.
Right.
Okay, because that's their concern. They don't want to be having to call around.
They don't want to have to
know where to go.
That's right. And
okay,
to go.
So that's a major concern.
And there's a real, we subcontract with three different providers. So right now we're using RTS. We're using Life, a substance abuse provider in downtown Graham, and we're using a sexual offender provider in Randolph County.
But it all came through Algene or Gary.
It all comes through, and the county provides case management at this time.
Okay, so if you had your preference, how would you phrase this motion? I want to understand, because it's not automatic that by doing this we're going to submit a request for proposal. We're going to consider to submit a request for proposal.
Well, and I don't know that I want a motion as much as I wanted to inform you and get consensus about whether we go forward with working with the manager within our budget constraints and within the
counties.
Right. The issues with judicial services to decide whether we go forward with the RFP or not.
And my only comment to that, just point of order, it is on the consent agenda, which means it is an action item.
Okay.
So let me then ask Eddie, or Linda, if you are in a position to make a motion regarding the subject. Maybe you, since you were on the committee.
Yeah, I make a motion that we allow Susan to work with the county manager and to check and see what funds are available for this program.
All right.
Is that good enough?
And apply for the grant if
it's seen in the best interest.
It's seen in the best interest
of our citizens and the county.
That's
right. Okay. Thank you, Linda. Is there a second?
Second.
All right. Any other discussion or questions? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thanks, Susan.
Thanks.
Okay. Tori was kind enough to email to everyone a proposed committee assignment sheet for 2012, and Tori, I don't know if you heard back from anybody that this was unsatisfactory or changes. Without putting you on the spot, did you hear from anyone?
Just one.
What did I say? What?
She said she would be glad to assume.
Oh, no, I told her
soon.
Which ones I wanted.
Yeah, her job was. That's incorporated. That's incorporated. So there haven't been any changes since this proposed list. Okay. I didn't mean to put anybody in the spot. Okay, with that in mind, let's by consensus agree that this is okay with everybody, and everybody's seen the list. Tim, you're okay?
Yeah, I'm
okay. The one comment I would make, they are pretty spread out fairly evenly among all commissioners. I would encourage each of us at future board meetings, when we've had a meeting and there's been material discussion, such as Bill brought up the recreation issue, it would be good to share with the board, and let's make sure that our citizens are aware of the large amount of work that these different committees do and are involved, and the participation by the commissioners. And I do think, going back to the acronym thing, that it's probably not good for folks that come here that aren't day-to-day involved with these different agencies to hear all these acronyms.
And spell them out.
We need to start spelling them out and let everybody understand, you know, Part F, you know, that stands for something. And it's not buses.
No.
So, but I learned that again. The school system is probably the worst for that. So, and they do a good job of educating the public as well. Okay, so we're going to assume that these committee assignments are okay.
Yep.
Now, Craig wants to talk about our schedule a little bit and any other matters.
I'd give you a quick update on our sales tax collection as well. So, thank you, Mr. Chairman. So, we do appreciate it. Historically, we have canceled the first meeting in January, and right now that's scheduled for January 2nd, and wanted to see if that was still your wishes.
Board members?
I'm fine
okay with
that.
Me. Yep.
Okay with
anything
me.
Anything looming between now and then?
No.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Be gone.
Our second meeting in January is scheduled for January 16th, and that is Martin Luther King Day. We are lucky in the month of January that there's five Mondays. So if the board would like, we could go to the 23rd and still have 2 weeks between the next meeting.
Or we could meet the Tuesday after the Monday on the 17th.
Some of us have meetings on Tuesday.
Yeah, okay. Actually, there are a lot of board meetings.
I'm on the Board of Health, but I'm not sure.
Okay.
If that'll work, the 23rd?
Any objection with the 23rd? Tim, you okay with that?
Yeah, that would work.
We'll send out reminders to make sure.
I don't plan that far ahead, so I don't know what I might have come up.
Okay, well, then by consensus, let's go with January 23rd. And Tori, then, will you send out the calendar and also schedule of commissioner invocation to everyone, and we'll go with that.
Okay, and I do want to give you a quick update on the sales tax update for the month. I believe you got a copy in your update, is that currently per the year we're up 10.7% over last year, and right now at half of the year we're at 47% of budget, so which is good compared to where we have been. Let's encourage people to buy more Christmas. Six more shopping days. So spend that money in Alamance County. So but we're holding our own. So
Yeah, I think the real test will be what we actually see along about the 1st of March in terms of year-end and even January for
yes,
the
sir.
Returns and so forth.
Yes, sir. We again, we had a 21% increase for this month for it was September over this time last year.
Well, that has to be good.
Yes.
It just does.
But that's all I have this time.
Okay, thanks, Craig. Linda pointed out, and I'm glad she did, Tori, there's a couple of meeting times that have been changed since these committees were last updated. And Linda's, when is your change?
Executive Order for Piedmont Triad Regional Council, which is PTRC, is at lunch now instead of 5:30.
Still the second Tuesday?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, if you could make that change, Tori, and also the Alamance County Transportation Authority, which is the third Wednesday of the month, is actually at 4 p.m. Guys, any other changes that you see? Everything else look right? If you do have a change or there's a change, let's let Tori know. If you could send out a new one with those changes.
And Tori, I'll make sure that they have not changed that back because we have been meeting at lunch for the last 3 or 4 months.
Okay, now let's address the consent agenda. We pulled off and approved items F and G. Let's review the remaining of the consent agenda, and I would entertain a motion to approve that agenda.
So moved.
Thank you, Bill. Thank you, Linda. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay. We are going to make a motion here in a second to go into closed session. Prior to doing that, I just want to thank all of you for being here in case you're not hanging around for the results of the closed session. I do hope you have a Merry Christmas, and we'll see everybody. Bring all your friends back on January 23rd, right?
Yes, sir.
And we'll go from there. Okay. And with that, I move that we now go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute Section 143-318.11A4. To discuss matters relating to the location or expansion of industries or other businesses in Alamance County, including agreement on a tentative list of economic development and incentives that may be offered in negotiations. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? We'll go into closed session. And who made the second? Who you want me to give credit to?
Give me.
Motion to return to open session.
So moved.
Thank you, Bill. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Eddie. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? The board met and reached a tentative consensus on incentives to be offered to a company and instructed the county manager to communicate that incentive to the company. We met and discussed a company known as Burlington Technologies. They have approached the county through the chamber to request a public hearing that would involve an incentive from the county based on potential new employee base of 140 people. And that public hearing has been scheduled for Monday at 12 o'clock on January 9th, 2012, at which time the full details of their request will be made available. However, the letter that we have from Burlington Technologies will be made available to the press immediately following this meeting. And the vote to schedule the public hearing was 5-0. Now, we're nearing the end of the night. Are there any further commissioner comments?
Let the record show that your second meeting was 2 hours.
I do need to work on that.
Tom, I just want to mention one thing. The Piedmont Food and Agricultural thing, we're working. As they're working actually putting together a resolution to move that from government run to a nonprofit, and hopefully they'll get that done next first part of next year.
Yep.
And that will change the status and help the guy that's trying to get this thing off the ground and get some of the government stuff out of there so he can actually run it and get it rolling.
Well, now, I'm reading between the lines. Does this mean you're trying to get out of a committee or something?
No, actually, I'll probably remain on that because it's some spots for
yes.
the counties yeah. that are involved I was stay active.
Yeah, that's an important area.
But now that we've done committee assignments, yeah, that's why I wanted to wait.
Exactly, exactly. All right, thanks, Eddie, for that update. Any other announcements? Well, if not, again, thank you for those that remained here. Please have a Merry Christmas, and we'll see you next year.
Very good.
Thank Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.